Good day and welcome to our online service. It's so good to have you join us once again. And we want to dive right in. We're trusting God for a very special time. So let's open in prayer together. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you that wherever we are today, we know that you are God with us. And we pray, Lord, that during our service today, we're going to feel connected first and foremost to you. We're going to know your presence with us. And we're going to have the joy of knowing that today we worship with millions and millions and millions of worshipers all across the planet who are lifting you up, Jesus, and exalting you today. So, Lord, we pray that you would come and have your way in this time. Bless this time. Our hearts are open, Lord, first to bring you our praise and worship, but also to receive, Lord, that ministry which you have for us today. Be exalted, Lord. Have your way. Your kingdom come, your will be done. We pray in this time, here on earth, as it is in heaven. We ask this now in Jesus' name. And together we said, amen and amen. Wonderful. Won't you join with us as we praise and worship our King? Let's praise him together.
As dark try to hide you and steal you away. Death try to keep you inside of the grave. For freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Our fears and our faith, and dead on the cross. You cannot be stopped. Move around mountains, break corrupt chains. Jesus' triumph over the grave. Sing hallelujah, battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Stand on your victory, shout your praise. Miracle maker, you're mighty to save. Against our God.
There's not a mountain that he can't
Oh,
Amen. Amen. A big, big thank you once again to our team, our musos, and just a wonderful time of praise and worship as always. Cool. So we're going to dive straight in to the message today. As you know, if you've been with us over these past weeks, we are busy with a series called Seize the Day for Jesus. That's the qualification. And if you are joining us today for the first time, once again, so great to have you join us. We're busy with a series where we're really looking at living one day at a time, especially in a pandemic like this, but one day at a time, looking to grab hold of and to get the most out of each and every single day for Jesus Christ. Now, over the last couple of weeks, actually, we've been looking at slamming the door in the past, and you remember we said we do want to hold on to and carry forward with us the happy memories that we have. We also want to especially remember God's works in our lives and His words over our lives. Now, as I was driving this week, I thought of another qualification, something I also need to bring in. Might be stating the obvious, but it's important to point it out. And it's this. We also want to carry forward with us the lessons we've learned, especially from mistakes and failures in the past. The last thing we want to do is to keep on going round and round the mountain, so to speak, and making the same mistakes, going through the same failures, and committing the same sins even over and over again. So by all means, learn from past mistakes and failures. Ask God to speak to you. Carry forward those lessons with you. But when it comes to the guilt and the shame of those mistakes, those failures, even of that sin, remember what we said, we've got to slam that in the past. Seal the door on that thing. Don't let the failures and mistakes of the past define your today and to define your tomorrow as well. Trust that makes sense. All right, so we're going to be turning our attention now to the present, to today, which kind of makes sense when the series is about seizing the day. And I really want to make this as practical as we can. Lots of practical wisdom, I trust, today as well. I hope you're going to find it helpful, especially this week and next week in particular, as we look at seizing today, being in the present. So here we go. Let me start off with this little illustration. There's a big wall over there, okay, to my left. Imagine that I walk over there. There's no one else here. Take off my shoe and sock on my right foot, and I stand there, and I kick the wall with all of my might. Then I time 5 minutes. Then I kick the wall again, and I repeat. 5 minute intervals, I'm kicking the wall. Now, let's say Dwayne is here with me. Dwayne comes looking for me at some stage after some time has passed, and there he finds me standing in front of the wall, face white, pale with pain. Won't even describe what my foot looks like, and maybe he witnesses me kicking the wall. Now, imagine that Dwayne runs up and cries out to God, "Oh Lord, please take Greg's pain away." Would God answer that prayer? Can God answer that prayer? Obviously He can. I've got testimonies of God taking pain away. Pain of a kidney stone. Literally lifting it and miraculously taking it away. God could. But the question we've got to ask ourselves is, would that be the right prayer to be praying in that situation? Wouldn't it almost be a little bit better to say, "Lord, help Greg to come to his senses and to stop kicking the wall." Maybe recognizing, Dwayne would have to recognize that he is the answer to his own prayer. And he would come and very lovingly and firmly try and get me away from the wall so he didn't have to phone some men with a nice tight-fitting little jacket for me to wear afterwards. Not so. And so, friends, this is the thing, is that sometimes more than simply taking the pain away, we've also got to pray and deal with and address that which is causing pain in our lives, especially where we are the contributing factor in that regard. So, you remember me sharing this Mark Batterson quote with you last Sunday? Here's the first part of it. He said, "You may not be responsible for what happened, but you are response-able," all right? And so the thing is that we're not always responsible for everything that's going on in our lives. But on the other hand, sometimes we are. Friends, sometimes we are, figuratively speaking, kicking a wall in our lives. We're causing pain to ourselves and potentially to others around us as well. And so the thing is we need to, it's not simply about taking the pain away. It's actually about addressing and putting a stop to that which is causing us to hurt ourselves. All right, and so we need to put a stop to that. So when we talk about carrying lessons forward, not only do we want to carry forward the lessons from the past, but we also want to be learning today. That's this first thing we're going to be looking at today as we look at seizing the day, seizing our today. We also want to learn today and carry forward with us lessons that we are learning today. And when it comes to this thing of kicking a wall in our lives, it's amazing, friends. Now, sometimes we do. Sometimes we're aware of it. We know. We realize, okay, I'm kicking a wall. But it's amazing, friends, how sometimes we can have blind spots. Something that should be so obvious, we are kind of blind to, we're oblivious to. And so it's so important that we are constantly listening for God speaking to us in our lives, to hear what he's saying. Because God will speak to us, especially through his word. You know, so many times I'm reading the word of God and the Spirit of God speaks to me. He addresses issues in my heart. God gives me warnings that if I'm not careful, I could be in danger of kicking a wall in a certain area of my life. So listening as we read God's word, listening to the Holy Spirit speak to us. And God can also speak to us through other people, those around us who care for us and love us enough to speak the truth in love. Those who could say to us, hey, but you are kicking a wall. You're hurting yourself. You've got to stop. All right? So God speaks in these ways. Now, Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 to 6 says this. It says, and have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, my son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines the ones he loves and he chastens everyone he accepts as his son. So in addition to the Lord speaking through his word, by the Holy Spirit, through other people, God can speak to us, friends, through circumstances. And sometimes we can be going through difficult circumstances where the Lord is lovingly bringing discipline in our lives. Don't miss what this verse makes so clear, that God loves us. He loves you. He loves me enough as his child to discipline us and to correct us. That, the word of God says, is a word of encouragement. It's a good thing, all right? And so seizing the day then is about constantly seeking to grow in knowing God, in knowing the ways of God, in hearing what God is doing, and even being open to correction that God is bringing in our lives. We want to keep in step with God. We want to move with God, okay? So we've been talking to start with about situations which we're responsible for, but what about the many circumstances and situations in life which you and I are not responsible for, okay? Even then, friends, there's still that opportunity to learn. And Grant Hansen, who's one of our elders here, sent an email out to us, and that was actually the previous week, and it was a message that John Piper had shared at a conference for missionaries. As I understand it, he was addressing a group of missionaries and potential missionaries, and he made this statement on more than one occasion. It went to this effect. He urged them not to waste the pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic. He shared this last year in the midst of the pandemic. And you might be thinking, huh? Don't waste the pandemic. Are you crazy? I just want this pandemic to be over. What are you talking about? What he did is he took them back to Acts chapter 7, where Stephen had been martyred. And then we read this immediately after in Acts chapter 8, verses 1 and verse 4. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem. And all the believers except the apostles were scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. Verse 4, but the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. And Piper goes on to make these observations in his message. He said, Jesus had told them in Acts 1 verse 8 to go from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And they were still in Jerusalem. Therefore, he dislodges them from Jerusalem and catapults them into his mission through suffering, Stephen's death, and a spreading persecution. The point he was making is that God can even use and work through hardships and suffering in our lives to mobilize us and to advance us according to his plans and his purposes. And he believed, John Piper believed, that this COVID-19 pandemic is going to see scores of missionaries sent out to proclaim the good news to a world that is desperate for good news right now. Okay? Remember what we also looked at last Sunday. We looked at the account of Jesus and his disciples caught in a storm out on the Sea of Galilee. And we made the point that for God, ending a storm is such an easy thing. God can change our circumstances like that. But we also made the point last Sunday that even more than changing our circumstances, the Lord is interested in changing us and working in us and through us, even in the midst of and through those very circumstances. So here's the thing. Perhaps you are going through a storm today. You might be going through a very hard season in your life today. And these things, the storm and the season you're going through, it's not something that you are responsible for, all right? Even so, friends, just know that with Jesus in the boat of your life, you will come through the storm. The storm will not overwhelm you, okay? But in the midst of this time, as challenging as it is, keep your heart open for what God is saying to you, what he wants to show you, what he wants to do in and through you. Be asking the Lord questions. Lord, what is it that you are wanting to teach me? What do you want me to learn in this time? You know, perhaps God wants you to grow in trusting him more. For instance, he might want to replace that fear that's been in your heart with his perfect peace. Lord, what do you want to show me about yourself Just show me about just the ways of God. What is it you're wanting to reveal? Lord, what is it that you could be wanting to correct in me even in this time? How do you want me to move forward? It's this thing, friends, of, and let me say this too, just to acknowledge that we ask lots of questions. We don't always get the answers to all of our questions, certainly not in this lifetime. But I do believe, friends, as there's this heart with a posture to learn, a heart that's seeking to know God, to grow in knowing Him, to know the ways of God, to listen to what He's doing in us and through us, a heart that's open to His correction and even His discipline and correction in our lives. Friends, this is something which is so important, I believe, to help us really seize the day. Amen? That's the first point. Second thing, let's move on to talk about the importance of making our beds, okay? Make your bed in the morning. So some of you might have heard of a speech by Admiral William McGraven. He'd been a Navy SEAL officer, among other things, and he was addressing a group of graduates at their graduation. And he said this, "If you want to change the world, start off by making your bed." All right? I'll just confess over here, this isn't always necessarily my biggest priority in the morning. There's sometimes where I say to Laurie, you know, babes, why don't we just let the bed air this morning? You know, just leave it open, you know? Laurie doesn't quite share my conviction when it comes to that point and leaving the bed open to air. But be that as it may, you could say, what's the big deal about making your bed in the morning? How could that possibly set you up to become a world changer? So the thing is this, is that Admiral McGraven went on from there to write a book called, wait for it, Make Your Bed, all right? And I'll let him explain in his own words the point he was making. He said this, if you did it right, the corners would be square, the covers pulled tight, the pillow centered just under the headboard, and the extra blanket folded neatly at the foot of the rack. It was a simple task, mundane at best. But every morning we were required to make our bed to perfection. It seemed a little ridiculous at the time, particularly in light of the fact that we were aspiring to be real warriors, tough, battle-hardened SEALs. But the wisdom of this simple act has been proven to me many times over. If you make your bed every morning, you have accomplished the first task of the day. The bottom line is this, friends. How you start your day is actually very, very important. It really is. The start of our day is so important. It's actually setting us up to seize the day. If you have one of those days where it just doesn't start well, it can feel like you're playing catch up the whole day long. And it feels, it's not impossible, but it feels so much harder to fully seize the day. So let's ask this question, okay? For the Jews, when does a day start? When does a day start for the Jews? Think about it, okay? Does it start at 1 second past midnight, as we would picture it? Could it be when the sun rises in the morning? While you're thinking about it, let me take you to this scripture, Genesis chapter 1, verses 3 to 5. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. God saw that the light was good, and He separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness He called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And if you look at it, this rhythm continues. There was evening, and there was morning, the second day. There was evening, and there was morning, the third day. Have you ever wondered why it's evening and morning, and not morning and evening as we might have imagined, the other way around? Okay? Well, the thing is this, friends, is that for the Jews, a day runs from one sunset to the next. So I used to work with some Jewish partners in a law firm. And on a Friday, they would leave, they would go off to prayer, and then they would go home and have the Sabbath meal on a Friday night. Now, I remember at the time I used to think, but that doesn't make sense. I thought Saturday is the Sabbath, so why would they have the Sabbath meal on the Friday night? It's because the Sabbath started sunset on the Friday and ran through to sunset on the Saturday. Okay, now here's the thing. Let me ask you, are you a night owl? You might not be. I am. My hand is in the air. I'm a night owl. Okay, now have you ever had times where, as a night owl in particular, you've stayed up much later than you should have? So the following morning, you're feeling like your brain is all foggy. You're feeling tired. You're feeling the effects of having stayed up far too late that night before. Okay, now it's easy to think, let's say it's a Monday night, it's easy to think, well, I ended my Monday quite badly. I stayed up too late, and now I'm paying the price on Tuesday the following day. Now, hear me carefully. I'm not advocating now that we adopt the Jewish way of seeing a day, sunset to sunset, but it is quite a mind-shifting kind of thought, friends, to think that if we're not getting the rest we should, it's not about ending a day badly. It's actually about starting another one badly. Think about it. So in other words, if I am too tired, if I'm not getting the rest that I should, I'm not exactly setting myself up to seize the following day. Isn't that so? Do you get it with me? All right. So it's a challenge for me. I've been thinking about this quite a lot as I've been prepping this week because I am prone to staying up later than I should. All right. So the point is this, friends, is that How we start a day is key in terms of moving in to seize hold of that day and to get all that we can from it for Jesus. Remember, McRaven said this. He said, when you've made your bed, you've accomplished the very first task of your day. Now, let's talk about that. Perhaps you're in a season now where sleeping in is definitely not an option. Maybe you've got little kids or you've got to get up really early for work purposes, whatever it is, okay? But you could probably think of a time in your life where you could sleep in a whole lot later. You know, like holidays or those times where you lie in bed till like 10 o'clock, roll out of bed, you mooch around for another hour or so. It's almost like forget breakfast. It's pretty much time for lunch. And if you have experienced this, even though you've got the whole afternoon and the evening still to come, it feels like the day is kind of gone. Have you had that feeling? Sometimes you go to bed like after a day like that. And yes, it's been a resting time, which is good. You kind of think, oh, I didn't really do anything today. Ever had those kind of days? Isn't that so? It's a sort of a thing of when you don't start the day and get some things going, it can almost feel like the whole day is just slipping past. And it's not necessarily a productive day. You with me? Okay. Now, this is the thing, friends, is if you think of what McRaven said, if you make your bed as the first kind of task, let's say, what you've done is you've accomplished, you can put a tick in a box next to a task, and that gives you a sense of momentum, a sense of actually being productive. So this is something I've experienced in my life, okay? So let me give an example where, let's say that a work day just feels like it's dragging along a bit. I feel like I'm in second or third gear, okay? What I'll sometimes do is stop, take out my phone, and go to my to-do list. Now, I might already have some things there, but I just start adding things to my to-do list. Even things that take like 30 seconds, okay? Almost takes as long to put it on the to-do list as it would to do it. But I do that. I get this list of things, and then I start hitting my to-do list. I'm focused. Phone that person, do that email, fetch that thing, do that. I'm just ticking things off on my to-do list as I'm going. Friends, that creates a momentum. There's such a sense of, hey, getting through things. So by the time you've finished your list, as it were, you're in top gear and you move forward and fly into, if I dare say, in top gear, all cylinders firing into the other things that you need to do from there, okay? It's a simple thing. But now I want to zoom in. It's not just a simple thing of just get something done for the sake of it. That first task, the first thing you do, you'd want it to be an important thing, isn't that so? You want a sense that it's not just getting something, not a tick in the box, but you've actually accomplished something that's important. The challenge we face, friends, is that so much of our lives, the urgent crowds out the importance. Isn't that so? Think about your early morning routine. So often, it's just about getting out of bed, getting going, getting the kids ready, and getting to work or to school, as the case may be. All right? So, how we start our day, though, is important because it has the potential to set up the entire day. So, Eben Pagan, which is quite a name, he said this. He said, your first ritual that you do during the day is the highest leveraged ritual by far, because it has the effect of setting your mind and setting the context for the rest of your day. So let's have a look at this in Jesus' life. How did Jesus start his day? Here's an example. Mark chapter 1, verses 35 to 39, we read this. Before daybreak the next morning, Jesus got up and went out to an isolated place to pray. Later, Simon and the others went out to find him. When they found him, they said, everyone is looking for you. But Jesus replied, we must go on to the other towns as well, and I will preach to them too. That is why I came. So he traveled throughout the region of Galilee, preaching in the synagogues and casting out demons. Now, the context for this little passage is actually high ministry demands. If you read about the previous day, Jesus had preached in the synagogue, he'd driven out demons, he'd healed the sick, all kinds of sicknesses. Okay, it was a big ministry day. Probably got to bed a bit late, but notice Jesus getting up early, going out to pray, and then straight away, Peter and the others come looking for him. Hey, Jesus. Everyone's looking for you. Come, Jesus, get busy. We got to get moving. There are demands out there, okay? But this is the thing, friends. Jesus was able to prioritize the important above the urgent. And Jesus was able to make time to spend with his Father. And from there, I believe it also kind of solidified it. Again, cemented for him what he was really called to. He was able to say to Peter and the others, no, 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 we're not staying here. We need to keep moving because that's why I'm here. That is my mission, why I've come to earth. And so this is the thing, friends. We don't know that Jesus started his day every day like this, but I kind of think it's an insight into how he probably started. I like to think, at any rate. Jesus, I'm sure, started the day in prayer. And I must say for myself, when I've started the day, or I certainly had some time with God near the start of my day is different. I don't know how you found that. Is that an amen for you too? Now, it doesn't mean that our day is perfect. It doesn't mean that we don't have our moments where the fruit might still come off the tree a little bit, if you know what I mean. Okay, not saying it's perfect, But the day, friends, is different when we begin the day with God. It really, really is, all right? And this is something, this notion of having some time with God is something that it can be quite a guilt trip for many Christians because we know that we should and we not. And then for many others, it's the kind of thing of just putting our hands up and saying, well, you know what? I'd like to, but I'm too busy. I don't have time to spend with God in my rushed morning schedule. Okay, so with those two thoughts in mind, let's have a look at these. Just some things to help maybe. So R.A. Torrey said this about D.L. Moody. He said, every day of his life, I have reason for believing he arose very early in the morning to study the Word of God, way down to the close of his life. Mr. Moody used to rise about 4 o'clock in the morning to study the Bible. He would say to me, if I'm going to get in any study, I have to go to get up before the other folks get up. And he would shut himself up in a remote room in his house, alone with his God and his Bible. All right? The lesson that we can learn from a man who was as busy as any of us are, and we see the same thing coming through in Jesus' life, is that we need to make time for that which is important to us. Not to wait for some gap to open up somewhere in our diary, but to make time. Now relax, I'm not advocating that we all get up before daybreak. That would be a massive challenge for someone like me, I'm honest. But the thing is, with a few tweaks, a few adjustments, friends, it's possible for all of us to make time for that which is most important. And I want to suggest the most important thing of all is to begin our day with God. Okay, now, for those again who are prone to guilt trips around the thing of quiet times, for those who feel like there is no time at all, please remember that there's no minimum time prescribed in the Bible. Nowhere does the Word of God say, thou shalt spend 1 hour or 2 hours every day with the Lord thy God. Okay? It's not prescribed. And I've often said to people, honestly, to spend 15 minutes, even 10 minutes a day with God every day is better than 0 minutes a day. I promise you it will make a difference in your life, especially when it's near the start of your day. And this is coming from a night owl. Please hear me, okay? Now, here's something very practical, especially if you think, oh, how do I do this, okay? Here's an idea. Have you heard of habit stacking? Habit stacking. So what you do is you take something you're already doing, it's already part of your life, part of your routine, if you like, and you add to that something, especially something new that you're wanting to introduce or something that might take a little bit more discipline, and you do these things together. So here's an example. Let's say that you want to grow as a leader, all right? You're wanting to grow in leadership, and you're also someone who exercises 3 or 4 times a week. You're already exercising, so when you exercise, pop in your headphones and listen to some great leadership podcasts on growing as a leader, okay? Or listen to an audiobook about leadership. Easy to do. You can do the same thing when you're driving in your car. Now, here's another one. Here's the question. How many of you pretty much start the day or near the start of your day, you're enjoying a cup of tea or a cup of coffee? Not so? I mean, for some of us, we can barely get going until we have that little caffeine boost near the start of our day. Most of us are doing. Now, what happens? You take your cup of coffee, you take your cup of tea, and what do you do? Flipping through Facebook. My case, often looking at catching up on the Supersport website, seeing what happened in the world of sport the night before, just catching up on news, etc., etc. Okay, so here's a thought. Why not take that cup of tea, take that cup of coffee, sit down, and have a coffee date, a tea date with Jesus. Open up your Bible, read one passage, meditate on what you've just read. Let God speak to you through His Word, and then you speak to Him. Like Jesus, even getting clarity for what it is that God's calling you to, what He wants to take you into in that day. Friends, that could take 15 minutes, it could take 10 minutes. Your day would be so different if you started that way, all right? Now, please hear me on this too. It's not some legalistic thing. Honestly, if you're someone who leaves for work early in the morning, by all means, beat the traffic, get to work, then have your cup of coffee and your coffee date with Jesus. If you're a mom who feels like it's a blur, just a rush trying to get the kids to school, by all means, get them to school and then come and sit with your cup of tea and have that tea date with Jesus. I promise you, it will make a difference. It really, really will. Okay? How we start our day is vitally important. It sets us up to seize the day, and there's no better way to start the day than to start it in the Word of God and in the presence of the Lord. Amen. All right. One more thing. Mark Batterson tells the story of how they built a suspension bridge across the Niagara Gorge. You've heard of the falls? So this is the gorge that leads up to the falls. And so the point that they wanted to cross, it was something like 240 meters wide, plus minus, cliffs about 70 odd meters high that dropped down to this rushing river that was heading towards the falls. How do you cross something like that? How do you, in the 1800s, build a bridge to span a gap like that? Answer, you have a kite flying contest. That's right. That's what they did. In January 1848, hundreds of kids entered the kite flying contest. And I think it went on for a little while, but eventually a 15-year-old American kid managed to fly his kite across the gorge. He won the grand prize of $10. I think it was worth a whole lot more back then, all right? So anyway, what do they do next? Now they've got the kite string across. They attach to that string a stronger line, pull the stronger line across. Then to that stronger line, they attach an even stronger line. And so they built up to a rope, and then eventually they built up to a steel cable, 36-strand steel cable. And so friends, the first step in building the suspension bridge across the Niagara Gorge was a kite string. That's right, okay? Zechariah 4 verse 10 says this, "Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hands." Okay? We sometimes despise, we kind of look down on small beginnings. We look at things and think, that's insignificant. It's a little kite string, man. Come on. What possible impact could that have in my future? Friends, God looks at us and God rejoices those first steps we take, especially when there's something He has for us. And we take those first tottering steps towards it. Just like we say there's nothing too big for God, let's also not forget there's also nothing too small for God, okay? And Mark Batterson has this brilliant quote, actually, which I'd like to share with you. He says this, "I know people who say they'll give more when they make more. I'm not buying what they're selling. I know people who say they'll serve more when they have more time. We've already debunked that myth. You don't find time, you make time. And I know people who think they'll be ready to step up when the big opportunity presents itself. Not if they aren't taking advantage of little opportunities right here, right now. How you do anything is how you'll do everything." I'm going to say that again. How you do anything is how you'll do everything. He also goes on to say, do little things like they're big things. So what's this all about? Okay, it's seizing even the little opportunities, those kite string moments today. Let's say that there's a call on your life to preach or to teach God's word to other people, okay? Don't sit around waiting for this day when Gabriel appears with a legion of angels and they pick you up and they transport you to some distant land where a million people are sitting under a tree waiting for you to preach the word of God to them. I'm being ridiculous on purpose. Obviously, I am, okay? But the point is this, friends. If you're called to preach or to teach, study God's word now. Equip yourself now in the word of God. Start writing out messages. Go and preach to the trees in your garden. I mean, Angus used to go out to his fields and preach to them. Grab hold of your spouse. You've got a captive audience, as it were, same household. Get your best friend. And then, friend, especially when God opens up ministry moments, even if there's one person, it's usually like that one person, speak and minister the word of God into that person's life. Don't overlook, friends, those moments that look so small, that look so insignificant, because that's the thing. It might be a kite string today, but if you are faithful with it, if you do that little thing like it's a big thing, guess what? As you trace it through, that kite string, friends, eventually leads to a suspension bridge across a gorge, calling of God for your life. All right? I just encourage you. So, three big things from today. Keep on learning. Keep on growing in God. Ask God what He's doing. Ask God what He's showing to you, what He's saying to you, even the correction that He's bringing in your life. Start the day well. Your start to the day can set up your whole day for seizing the day for Jesus. And there's no better way to start than to spend some time at the start, near the start, with God. And then thirdly, don't despise the little opportunities, those little things that might look so insignificant to you. Because those are things, friends, as you do those things faithfully and you do them as if they were big things, God leads you on towards those bigger things that He has for you in the future. Amen. Studies have been carried out on people who would be regarded as some of the most successful people in the world. And there is one common denominator, one thing that truly stands out and sets the ultra performers apart from the rest of us. Okay, I'm in the rest of us group, I would say as well. All right. Would you like to know what that one thing is? Great. Please come and join us next Sunday, either online or at 24 Queen Series when you're going to open that up. You can look forward to it then. All right. Let's pray together. Let's pray. So Lord, we just thank You again, Lord, for this wonderful truth that every day when we awake, it's a day You've given us. Lord, it is a new day in You. It's a day to rejoice. It's a day, Lord, to grab hold of the opportunities, the moments that You give us. And Lord, I want to start out by praying that we'd start the day well and that we would start the day with You. I've just thrown out a few ideas today, Lord, but whatever way that works out, I pray, God, that we would start the day with You, knowing that it's not a chore. It's not a duty, it's not some legalistic thing, but it is a privilege to be able to come into the presence of the Lord Almighty and to begin our day with our eyes fixed on you, King Jesus. So I pray that you'd give us grace and help us with that. I pray, Lord, we would be a people that every day our hearts are set to learn mode. We are just ready to receive from you, to hear from you, to learn, to grow in knowing you, in knowing your ways, in recognizing what you're doing in us and through us. Even, Lord, being quick to discern correction when you need to bring it in our lives. We pray that to you, Lord. And then, Lord, I pray that we would not despise small beginnings. Lord, so often we dismiss things. We look at a kite string and think, what on earth could that possibly, what benefit could that be? How could that play any role in my future? But Lord, we thank you that in you, Lord, there is no small thing, as it were. And we thank you, Lord, too, that we would do even the little things. We'd grab every opportunity and do it as if it was a big thing, knowing, Lord, that you are faithful to bring us into the fuller picture of what you've prepared for our lives. So we pray this now, Lord. Thank you for just your hand upon us. Lead us, we pray, into this week. We ask for this now, just your protection over us, your blessing upon us. In the name of Jesus, we ask. And together we said, amen and amen. Thank you so much. Just if I could invite those of you who are ready to give at this point, if you've come ready to give, the giving details will come up at the end as they always do. And I'd just like to pray with you, or perhaps if you've given in this last week or so, we'd love to just pray with you as well. So please join me as we do. And just say, Lord, again, thank you, as we always thank you, that you're our provider. And I wonder if you just join me in stopping, you know, just for a moment. We can take God's provision so lightly, but I'm sure in some way, whether it was finances, whether it was some other answer to prayer, just to stop and think of a time where God came through in the most unlikely and incredible way. Would you do that just for a moment? I was challenged in a Bible study I was doing in this past week just to think about that. And I remembered a time where God came through in the area of finances in a way that just blew me away, a way that I couldn't understand. It was just God. And whether it's the big things again or the small things, Lord, we just recognize that you're so faithful as our provider. You're incredible, Lord. You're amazing. And so, Lord, with confidence today and with grateful hearts, we bring our tithes and offerings to you, knowing, Lord, that even as we give to you, we can never outgive you, Lord God. Thank you for your favor over our lives, your blessing, your provision, your protection. We don't take it for granted. We thank you today. And so, Lord, as we give you these tithes and offerings, we pray your blessing upon them and their administration. We ask for this now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Wonderful stuff. So, next Sunday, I'm looking forward to unpacking that one big thing. It is a big thing, I think. I think it's something really important. But have a great week. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Thank you.
Let us worship. Come, let us bow down. Come, let us magnify the King. The stars in the heavens with the angels shout, and all creation worshiping. It's a symphony of worship to the uncreated King, Jesus our Savior, Lamb that is risen, Lion that roars, Lion that roars, Lion that roars. Come, Jesus. worship to the uncreated King, Jesus our Savior, Lamb that is risen, Lion that roars, Lion that roars.